I count. Therefore, I count. Well, I'm paraphrasing Descartes a bit there. For as long as there have been human beings, there have been mathematicians. Think about it. No one really knows where math began, but counting seems like a pretty reasonable start. And we human beings probably counted things almost from the get-go. The number of fingers on a hand, the number of mammoths grazing on a hill, how many siblings we had. We could count on and on. Which has led us to tough questions like, how do you organize your number system to deal with things you can't count on your fingers? Or is there even such a thing as a negative number? Different cultures have come up with different answers. The Mayan calendar system is well known for its impressive accuracy, while the Incas could record vast numerical information, like accurate census data, using knotted string quipus. And negative numbers first showed up in China during the Han Dynasty as a way to solve multiple equations at once. In India, they were used to represent debts. And in Europe, negative numbers were called absurd numbers and up until the 18th century, dismissed as meaningless. Basically, arithmetic, the study of numbers and how we manipulate them, has changed a lot throughout history. So today, we'll take a look at the current consensus and decide how all this relates to algebra. G'day, I'm James Tanton, and this is Study Hall Algebra presented by Arizona State University and Crash Course. To unlock the secrets of arithmetic, we're going to use 10 minutes to build a few of the same realizations that human beings had over the millennia. If establishing counting numbers, which are positive whole numbers like 1 or 2 or 77, was the very beginning, maybe the next leap would be combining groups of things. So let me draw a picture. But rather than fingers, mammoths, or siblings, which are fun but somewhat distracting, let's just draw dots. And let's start with 5 dots, which we can also think of as 2 dots followed by 3 dots. 2 plus 3 equals 5. I just read the picture from left to right, because I'm used to reading in English. But if we read the picture from right to left, like we're reading Arabic or Hebrew, we'd see 3 plus 2. Of course, the 5 dots stayed the same, so 3 plus 2 also equals 5. We see the same pattern in multiplication. Reading left to right or right to left doesn't matter. We get the same answer. With counting numbers, 4 times 5 means 4 groups of 5. So let's be organized and draw our 4 groups of 5 in rows. And if we shift our perspective and look at the columns, you also have 5 groups of 4. And this is called the commutative property, the idea that you can add or multiply numbers in any order and get the same answer. Right now, our pictures have only told us that the commutative property works for counting numbers. So in algebra, we have to decide whether x plus 2 equals 2 plus x, or 5 times x equals x times 5, works no matter what type of number x is. And spoiler alert, it will. Of course, drawing dots has its limits. Think about how awful it would be to have to draw a picture of 37 times 34 in dots. Even using numbers, we humans really aren't good at picturing quantities larger than what we can count on our fingers. But we've come up with ways to get by. For instance, we can think of this multiplication problem as finding the area of a rectangle, and then we write 37 as 30 plus 7, and 34 as 30 plus 4. And these smaller rectangles are much friendlier. 30 times 30 is 900, 30 times 7 is 210, 30 times 4 is 120, and 7 times 4 is 28. We can add all these together and get 1,258, exactly as if we'd drawn 37 groups of 34 dots and counted them. This rectangle chopping is the heart of the distributive property, which says if you multiply two things by a number and then add the results, you get the same answers adding the two things first and then multiplying the result. And we'll see the distributive property also holds in all of algebra as well, including for numbers like fractions and negatives. We can use it to solve a classic algebra problem like this and figure out how to rewrite it without parentheses. Rectangles are again the answer. We'll multiply everything out and then add the results. X times x is x squared, x times 2 is 2x, x times 5 is 5x, and 2 times 5 is positive 10. Adding like terms together, the whole expression becomes x squared plus 7x plus 10. It's just like what we saw when multiplying 37 and 34, only with some unknowns this time because we're dealing with algebra. We'll revisit expressions like these later, especially when we're discussing polynomials. But for now, remember that you can always divide and conquer. So we've come up with different ways to count up. But what about counting down? Not long after we began to work with the counting numbers, we developed the concept of the negative numbers for losses, debts, days in the past. If I owe my sister a sheep, and then I acquire two sheeps, at the end of the day, I'm left with just one lonely sheep. It's this one. His name is Dale. Today we call positive and negative whole numbers like 5 and 0 and negative 47 the set of integers. In modern mathematics, to keep track of our debts, we represent a negative number by attaching a little dash to its left. But if we keep stacking up negatives, that gets a little confusing. I mean, what's negative negative 1 or negative 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 1? To think about this, we can go back to dots for a moment and represent negative numbers as antidots that cancel out dots. So negative 1 appears as the opposite of a dot, an antidot. Negative negative 1 would be the opposite of a dot, which is a dot. And negative 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 1 is the opposite of the opposite of the opposite of a dot, back to an antidot. Using dots, let's look at 5 plus negative 3. We see some dots and antidots cancel out, and we're left with two dots. And if we have something like 5 minus negative 1, that looks like 5 plus the opposite of negative 1. So this is 5 plus the opposite of an antidot, or 6 dots altogether. The idea that subtracting a negative is the same as adding a positive can get tricky when it intersects with the distributive property, especially when you have variables in play. So let's look at this through the math logs. Step right up. Here it is, folks, the fastest hands in the West. You won't believe your eyes. Here we have black cards, and here we have red cards, 10 of each. Shuffle them up, and we get two piles. Count them, 1, 2, with 10 cards in each. Now watch closely here, there's nothing up my sleeve. I say the number of black cards on the left is the same as the number of red cards on the right. Gasp! Someone get that poor lady some smelling salts. She was overwhelmed by the wonder of math. Can you see the trick? If we want to represent this with algebra, let's say that B is the number of black cards in the left-hand stack. Then the remaining 10 minus B black cards must be in the right-hand stack. Now, because there are 10 cards in the right-hand stack and 10 minus B of them are black, the number of red cards in the right-hand stack must be 10 minus 10 minus B. Let's turn our subtraction into addition, like before. This is really 10 plus the opposite of 10 minus B, or 10 plus negative 10 plus B. We just take the opposite of each term. Ah, the tens must cancel, and we're just left with B. And this makes sense for two reasons. First, we know we have to have a positive number of red cards and black cards on each side, and negative B means nothing here. Second, we've already seen in the demonstration that the number of black cards in one stack is equal to the number of red cards in the other stack, and the left stack had B cards, B black ones. But now we have proved with the power of algebra that this will always be the case. Okay, algebra can be pretty tricky, but we can handle it. So we can add and subtract negative numbers. And multiplying them doesn't seem so bad as long as only one of them is negative. If I'm given negative 5 times 4, it feels a little weird to think about making negative 5 groups of 4, or adding 4 negative 5 times. But 4 times negative 5 is easier. 4 groups of 5 antidots is 20 antidots. Thanks, commutative property. But when you multiply negative by negative, we've all been told you get a positive. And that seems kind of arbitrary. So let's look at an example to try to explain why this must be true. We can set up 17 times 18 like we did earlier, where we multiply each bit separately and then just collect them together at the end. 10 times 10 is 100, 10 times 7 is 70, 10 times 8 is 80, and 7 times 8 is 56. Add all those up and you get 306. But what if we wrote 17 and 18 as 20 minus 3 and 20 minus 2? The size of the rectangle is still the same, 17 and 18, we just changed the way we wrote them. 20 times 20 is 400, 20 times negative 3 is negative 60, 20 times negative 2 is negative 40, and let's just leave that negative 2 times negative 3 a mystery for now. So 400 plus negative 60 plus negative 40 plus our mystery m must equal 306, or 300 plus m equals 306. So the product of negative 2 and negative 3 has to be positive 6. Because we never changed the area, just the way we wrote our numbers. And it's weird, and there's no denying that it's weird. But there's just no other way that could be anything else. A negative times a negative just has to be a positive for all the rest of mathematics to hold together. Who knew negative numbers were so important? When I first learned these ideas, I took them at face value and just thought they'd existed since the dawn of time. But our ideas of math are constantly changing as we learn more about the world. And in algebra, we need to pay attention to these patterns that emerge, since our variables can be any type of number. Next time, let's look at another system of numbers where the rules may seem strange, the world of fractions. Until then, cheers. Thanks for watching Study Hall Algebra, which is produced by Arizona State University and the Crash Course team at Complexly. If you liked this video and want to keep learning with us here at Study Hall, be sure to subscribe. You can learn more about ASU and the videos produced by Crash Course in the links in the description. So, see you next time.